want to thank you for coming today. And my name is Pastor Don Rowe. I'm the pastor of Community Church. And a couple things I want to share with you. First of all, you're going to be famous today. Because you see that over there. And you see that over there. And so this is going to be videotaped. And so you just may end up being famous. So watch out. Maybe that's a good thing. But anyway, just want to let you know that this will be videotaped. I also want to thank those persons who part of the planning group to help create and sponsor and publicize this event. I want to thank them for all their work. And years ago, I'd love to say, since coming to the Legion World, I have not had the opportunity to do any confirmation classes, okay? That's usually early teen years. But an important theme in all the confirmation classes I did, whatever church I served in, was to talk about the sanctuary. Because every sanctuary has its stories to share, its message to share. And a very important part of the story that's being shared in relationship to the gospel of Jesus Christ here at Community Church is in relationship to these beautiful stained glass windows. Some of us here might have been, this may be our first time in here. Some of us are here often, almost every Sunday. And yet, we're, the commonality, the common bond, is that we face these stained glass windows and give thanks for the message that's being conveyed. And also the message that's being conveyed through our church organ, through Eric's work, and Stella, who will be our singer. The messages of Jesus Christ being conveyed through music. So I want to thank you for coming today. And just want to point out one correction in our program, our bulletin this morning. After I offer the prayer, Stella and Eric will be sharing in a musical version of the Lord's Prayer. And then, down at the bottom, next to the last item listed, then Stella and Eric will share with us Knees to the Earth. That switch in the music, if you will, help logistically as we shift around in terms of the stained glass windows. So welcome again, and let us join together in prayer. Creator God, we give thanks for those persons who did their creative work in relationship to our church organ, in relationship to these stained glass windows. In a very real way, O God, those persons co-created in relation to your co-creating work. We give thanks, O God, for the stories and the messages that are conveyed in relationship to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We give thanks, O God, for the hands that helped to create this event. And in our time together here, we give thanks, O God, for your Holy Spirit woven in our very midst. It's in your Son's name, O God, we pray. Amen. Welcome.
Thank you. Nelson, the organist of this church. I've been here for just over a year now, and it's been my pleasure to get to know the organ. Every organ is different. If it's an electronic like this, yes, they will have a model, and many of them will be the same. If it's a pipe organ, those are usually custom-made for a church. But this is an Allen organ, so we're going to talk about that today. It is an electronic organ. There are no pipes involved with this, though I think there might be spacers. In order to understand an Allen electronic organ or any electronic organ, you need to understand a pipe organ, which is, this is basically an imitation of a pipe organ. When I first started out as an organist, organists would be caught dead playing an electronic because they were just not very good. And about 35 years ago, the digital revolution.
Okay. About 35 years ago, with the digital revolution, all of a sudden things got a lot better, and the sounds, the imitation of the pipes got a lot better. So this is, again, an imitation of a pipe organ. They have two keyboards sometimes. These are keyboards here. Or they have three keyboards, like this organ does. Or four. The largest pipe organ that I know of has seven keyboards, which would be pretty much like up here. I have no idea where they're looking for the music. It must be up there. But anyway. These white knobs here that I pull out are called stops. And they represent one voice on one keyboard. So if I pull out this knob here, that's this sound here. On a pipe organ, you would have one pipe for each note. Each note would have to have a separate pipe. So you would have 61 pipes in one on one stop here. You can play one at a time, like I just did. Or you can play a lot at a time. Obviously, the more voices you have, just like the choir, the bigger the sound. So, it's not unusual for a pipe organ to have thousands of pipes, really, because if you multiply 61 times each one of these, it adds up very quickly. The organ console that I'm sitting at is really, if it were a pipe organ, would be just really the tip of the iceberg, or the face, and the body, or the pipes, would be somewhere else, in a back room, a couple of back rooms. Sometimes you see organs with all on the front, you think, wow, that's a lot of pipes. That's just a small portion of like one rank of pipes. And all the rest of them are somewhere in the back. But electronic organs, which this is, don't need all that space. A full rank of pipes, which would take up, you know, a good set of space in a room, can be taken by just a chip that you put in the organ. So obviously the whole organ on this one is all right here. The only thing extra that we need are speakers, and those are located up there. Sometimes you can put speakers in the back and have an antiphonal organ or the side or something, but we just have it up here. Let's talk about the voices. I gave you a handout. Hopefully you can see one. Those are all the different voices that are on the organ. There's a lot of them. After each name, you also see a number, like 16, 8, 4, 2, or so on. Those refer to the pitch level of the pipes. If I have middle C, let's use that. That's middle C on the organ. That pipe is 8 feet tall. Okay? If I wanted to play an octave lower, that would be a 16-foot tall pipe. Okay? And this, but I could do that automatically. I don't have to answer. So this is an 8 foot. If I put down stop that's marked 16, automatically adds that extra voice an octave lower. If I put down an octave 4 foot pipe would be higher. pipes, the pipes range in size from like a pencil size, sometimes even smaller than this, which would sound, you can hear it. Okay, those are very, very little tiny pipes, if they were pipes. On the other end of the spectrum, you have the low pedal voices, and the lowest pedal for that, we actually have one here, is a 32-foot pipe, about this big around, and when the air goes through it, you can hardly hear. You hear that? It's more of a rumble. I'll move up the scale a little bit so you can hear. So when you add that to the 16-foot, the 8-foot, 4-foot, then you start to get a big depth of sound. Let's go back to our principles here. We also have something called mixtures, and you see the mixtures have Roman numeral added. That's the amount of pipes per note. For instance, on the grade I have with my, in fact, I'm going to take off that one so you can hear better. Here's my 8 4-foot principal, so that's 2 pipes at a time. If I add a mixture, what that is some very small pipes, and there are 4 per note in different pitches, so that adds brilliance to it. Let me do it.
Here's the regular.
Verse of the hymn, or probably I usually bring it in like the second verse, because there's a lot of mixture, so we just keep getting bigger and bigger. Also for the postlude, this is my postlude stop. This organ is 30 years old, and when it came out, this was the big thing. So what you can do on this is you can actually program in a new voice. This is called the solutional 8-foot. Exactly what it says down here, but it's a different, bigger sound. So I program that in. And now I've got it. Here's the regular sound. Here it is with the car. So it gives me more sound. All this is the stuff that an organist has to be considering and thinking of when you start a piece. What sounds am I going to use? Well, it could take a half hour to go through the sounds and say, yeah, no, until you find the gain. Okay, those are the softer sounds. Those are usually used for backgrounds, possibly. For solos, you want like an orchestra, you want an oboe or a flute or something like that. Those are what we call reeds. You have the good loud reeds like the trumpet. Whenever I use that, I usually kind of beef it up with some other stuff.
Let's try that crystal glot. let's see what happens. All of a sudden you got something special. That's the only song that
so far that I've found that I can use that. There's got to be some others. I just need to remember to try it out and see. And the more times you try out different voices, the better the music begins to sound. So that appreciate. That's what I do. Now, when you're playing the organ, especially on the hymns, you come to the end of a hymn. The end of a verse, what are you going to do? Are you going to play the next verse the same? No, of course not. Organists don't play anything the same. So that's when you add something, usually. And so we have these things called pistons. If I had to reach over and grab all these, they wouldn't work. So we have buttons. That was my cancel button, which put them all back in. And I have pistons here, which can be set to whatever registration you want. And it automatically goes right to that. So this is my hymn pistons here. I start on 2 for the louder hymns, and I go up. For the prayer hymn, I start on 1. And you actually just start adding a couple of things up there. Each keyboard has its own pistons that affect only that keyboard. And then over here we have the generals, and those affect everything. And so with that, I can very quickly change all the sounds if I need to. So that's pretty much my spiel.
Thank you.
Fabulous. We learned more than we had ever known about the organ.
More than you ever wanted to know about the organ.
Excellent. Amazing, Eric. Thank you so much. The State Rods tour will begin with the lantern, which is right up here in the center. This is called a lantern, and the red triangle in the middle is called a triquetra. Anything that has three parts or three points on it in Christianity stands for Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and it is the flame of the triquetra. The circles around it are referring to the Lord, who is everywhere at all times, always and everywhere. Jesus said, I am with you always. And all the spines going out refer to that effect also, that the Lord is everywhere, around us, in the air we breathe, coming to us from one another as we care for one another. The Lord has said to love one another as you love yourselves. And so that is the outreaching of Jesus Christ, who loved us all, and the Lord our God, who loved all people and carried the Israelites for many, many years through the desert. Our monthly paper is also called the Lantern, and for that reason, because we have this lantern among us, always lifting our eyes and our hearts up to the Lord. Now we will start with the Old Testament prophets right here, the center window. This one on your blue paper started with the lantern, and the first window then is the prophets. There are an amazing number of prophets included in that window. Right in the center, we have Isaiah the prophet, and the seraphim flew to him carrying a coal in the tongs and touched his mouth with it because he said, my lips are unholy. I can't possibly speak for you, Lord. I'm not worthy. And when this was touched to his mouth, he became worthy and holy so that he could speak the words of the Lord, which is what prophecy means. Prophecy doesn't mean foretelling. Prophecy means speaking forth the word of the Lord. So the Lord gave him the words to say. The writers of the Bible were given the words to say from the Lord directly. All right, so some of the other prophets we have here. Up here, this sun-looking thing with the stream behind it, this is the Lord Jesus Christ coming with, for you, when I hear my name, the Son of Righteousness shall rise with healing in its wings. And I wanted you to see that shape more clearly. In the center of that little circle is the Chi Rho, which looks a lot like an X and a P, which is what the Greek letters look like. The Greek letter Chi is an X, the Greek letter Rho looks like a P, and that stands for Christus Rex, Christ the King. And you'll see that symbol in each of these three windows. Moving on to some of the other symbols that are in that window, we have Jeremiah. The yoke down here is the yoke of bondage, which Jeremiah remarks about. Over on the right, we have the city of Jerusalem burning because of the sword of the sword of justice. The people of Jerusalem have been ignoring God for a long time. And the prophecy was that the city would be burned down, and in fact it was. Over on this side we have symbols for Moses. This right here is a special symbol of Hebrew letters, which when Jewish people see these letters written in the scriptures, they do not pronounce it. As you can see, there are only four letters, and what they will say instead is Adonai, because it is inconsiderate, inappropriate to speak the name of the Lord. These letters are Yud He Vav He. The Yud, Hebrew letters, are both phonetic and also have connotations beyond the phonetics. The Yud is a hand. Can you see that little hand up there? He means behold. Vav is a tent stake. And then again, hey, behold. So right from the very beginning, the very first time that this symbol for the name of the Lord our God is used in the Old Testament, you have the phrase, behold the hand, behold the nail. Do you think God knew what he was doing right from the beginning? He had plans. So that's what that is in the scroll. That represents the scrolls given to Moses. The first five books of the Bible are said to be written by Moses, so he may have dictated it to his scribe. The one right under it, you can see the Star of David there. Star of David had a plumb line. The plumb line judges the verity, the truth of anything, and that's what that's about. When the scrolls, the Ark of the Covenant was stolen by the Philistines, they took it to their country, which is right along the Mediterranean. They took it to their country and they put it in the temple of Dagon. And the next morning, they found that the idol of Dagon had fallen on its face, crash, in front of the Ark of the Covenant. So they set it right back up again, and the next day it fell flat on its face again, and this time it hit the door post, and the head and the hands fell off of it. And so the people said, take this thing back where it came from. This is no good for us. And they set it on a cart and set it off into the wilderness, and sure enough, the animals took it back to where it belonged, in Jerusalem. Let's see, we have over here, we have the menorah of Hanukkah, the celebration of the 7 days, the 8 days that the oil continued to burn even when there was no oil. so you heard about the dreidel.
Dreidel, 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 I made it out of clay, and when it's dry and ready, the dreidel we will play.
It has four symbols around it, and the four symbols stand for here a great a miracle happened, and that's the Hanukkah miracle. Even in the New Testament, Jesus celebrated that holiday. Then down here we have the reconstruction of the walls of Jerusalem under Nehemiah, another one of the prophets. Over here we have the chariot of fire. Remember the movie, Chariots of Fire? Well, Chariots of Fire refers to when Elijah, with a J, Elijah the prophet, was taken up into heaven. This is one of the persons in the Bible who is recorded as not having died and gone to rest among his ancestors. Rather, he was taken up into heaven in something that was, how else could you describe it? In a flaming manner. And Elisha was there watching. Elijah had told him, if you see me leave, then yes, you may take my mantle and take my place. And that would be God's word to Elijah and to Elisha that he should take over. Over here we have one of our favorites, King David. King David, who, when he was but a boy, sang with his lyre to calm the soul of King Saul, the first king of Israel. Right here in the center of the crown is the Star of David. It's really hard to see it from here, but you know it's that the same six-point star we have here, two triangles together. And here we have the Lion of Judah, because from Judah, that was one of the 12 sons of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, one of the 12 sons of Jacob, Israel, the line of Judah would be the kingly line. And David is in the kingly line. Jesus also is in the kingly line, both through his mother and through his adoptive father. All right, moving on to Jesus' ministry, which is what is over on the left. Now that one, if you're going to be looking for it in your program, is on the other side. It's the second one down on the other side. I'm not sure what the order, why they were put in this order on here, but that's where we are. Okay, so Jesus' ministry. There is the winding path here, going up to, once again, we see the Cairo, Christus Rex. On this side over here, we have the fisher nets, because Jesus said to the fishermen that he gathered to be among 12, come and with me, and I will make you fishers of men, fishers of people. And here we have many people watching him. Here we have, remember the story of a little boy who hits loaves and fishes so that the Lord could feed the 5,000? Well, that's what that's about. We'll be stepping in and out of the sound wave here. Sorry. All right, there are two different stories in Scripture, one with 5,000 people on the grass and one with 4,000 people in the desert. They are two different stories. They're not the repeating of the same thing. And in this one, we have the loaves and the fishes. And not to waste anything, the Lord asked the 12 to go around and pick up the leftovers in baskets. These were lunch-sized baskets. There are different Greek names in the scriptures that refer to baskets and lunch-sized baskets. They picked up 12 lunch-sized baskets afterwards. There was enough food for all 5,000 people. Another one we have over here, you have Jesus speaking to Mary. Remember the story of Mary and Martha. Martha was busy about the housekeeping and about the cooking and serving. But Mary sat at Jesus' feet and listened to what he had to say, and he said, this is the more important thing. On this side we have an eye and a stretcher, a broken crutch, and an ear representing many miracles, the healing miracles of Jesus Christ. On the other side, we have gathering of the lamb. These are the three parables of things that are lost, the valuable things that were lost. The son, the father receiving his son back when he came back. And the message to us in all three of these is the Lord desires to have communication and loving embrace with each one of us. And he is so glad to have that, that he is thrilled when those who have fallen away choose to come back. So that is the prodigal son. And again, we have the lost sheep, the shepherd who goes to find the one lost sheep of the 100 and is thrilled when he finds it. And the lantern is the woman. What woman having lost a coin? Now that her coin represented her dowry, her security. Should anything happen to her husband, she wore these coins on her forehead, and they represented her security. What woman having lost a coin does not search the whole house over, having lit a lantern, and that's why that candle is there. And once she does find it, doesn't she throw a party for the whole neighborhood? She too is thrilled. Okay, over here on this side, we have the ministry of Paul. After Jesus Christ was crucified, died, and resurrected, and he said, I will cause you, my Holy Spirit will come to you. After I leave you, I will not leave you orphans, but I will send my Holy Spirit to you, and my Holy Spirit will bring to your mind all the things that you must remember, that you must write down. And Paul, who was not among the original 12, but who was ordained an apostle in a very special way. He was riding on a horse on his way to kill Christians when the horse bucked and he saw a bright light. Where did it go? We've got the horse throwing him here. And Jesus Christ, once again represented by the Cairo, says to him, Paul, Paul, Saul, his name was Saul, 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 why do you persecute me? And Paul says, who are you that I may worship you? And Jesus explained to him that Saul had been king against God, changed his name at that time from Saul to Paul, a renewal of life. In the center of this one, we have the Holy Spirit rising up from, and here we have the scrolls. Paul wrote many of the books of the New Testament. He was the one who wrote letters that were read in all the new churches. So we see a lot of his work. Paul was also imprisoned for a while, and these chains here represent the chains that he wore, and he refers to that in his writings. Don't worry about me here in chains. I'm here and I'm doing good things. Thank you for your support. And people sent him money to support so that he would have what he needed there. But also, he converted the palace guards. He made good use of his time. Over here we have the full armor of God. The breastplate of righteousness. Let's see if I'm getting any of this. We have the sword of the word. We have the helmet here. And this is just a really important scripture. To put on the full armor of God means to go out into the world prepared, because if your head if you have the helmet of salvation, you know that you are protected. You have a place in eternity. If you have the breastplate of righteousness, you know that you are following in the right way. You're doing the right things. And the sword of the word represents the Lord in very special ways. Now, Paul also was on shipboard, and then he went on several journeys into the different parts of Europe and Asia. And that's what the ship represents. And over here, this represents the prison that Paul was in, along with some of his friends. And the great earthquake came and broke the prison apart. The guard was about to kill himself because he would be slaughtered for letting everybody out. And Paul says, no, don't worry. We're all still here. Whereupon the guard was converted. He believed that Jesus Christ was who he said he was. And he followed Paul's teachings to know that. And he invited the prisoners to come to the fall. Well, thank you very much for this part. And now we have another beautiful offering from Stella. And then, after her song, we will all go down into the first couple of pews so that we can see these windows better.